Welcome everyone to the Arts Council of Big Sky Virtual Classical Concert, live from the Warren Miller Performing Arts Center. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Peter Bay, the music director of the Bravo Big Sky Festival and conductor of the Big Sky Festival Orchestra, joining you from Austin, Texas. Of course, we're disappointed that we can't host the festival in person this year, but so excited to offer tonight's special performance. Our first program features two of our longtime festival orchestra members, Carrie Krause and Julia Slovar. I can't wait to hear what they've prepared and to listen to it with you now. So I hope you enjoy the concert and look forward to seeing everyone again in Big Sky in 2021.
Thank you. Hello and welcome. The pieces that Julia and I are playing this evening are from a program that we've been working on called Shades of War. So perhaps you heard at the beginning of the set of pieces that it sounded like the military was starting to gather and to march. This set of pieces was by a composer, Glier, who was a Soviet composer. And this is from a set of eight pieces. We played three of them, Prelude, Versus, and Gavotte. And next, we're going to play one of the hallmark pieces written for this instrumentation, just violin and cello alone, by Kodai, the Kodai duo. And then we'll follow that up with the Ravel duo, which is the other piece that's the real staple of this repertoire. And these two pieces both bookend World War I, and hence the theme of this program, Shades of War. So Kodai was very much a big proponent of the Hungarian people, his home people. And so he used music as a way to further their identity, celebrate their identity, and he did this by going into the mountains and recording folk tunes. And so this piece in particular, out of his overall output, which was very, very long, he lived a long time, really exhibits that use of the folk idiom. And he was also inspired by Debussy and Ravel. The next piece we'll play was also very much inspired by Debussy. There's a lot of parallels between these two pieces. Is there anything I should add, Julia? Okay. All right. Well, we're going to play the first movement from Kodai's duo for violin and cello. Thank you.
The last set of pieces, the last piece that we'll play for you, is the sonata by Maurice Ravel. And as Carrie mentioned, it is a staple of the repertoire for violin and cello, and we're really grateful to have it. There are lots of amazingly beautiful things about it, and it's pretty unique, I think, even for his writing. There's a lot of, you'll hear a lot of watercolory sound and impressionism, especially in the first movement. You'll also hear a lot of angular moments that are still, I think, quite beautiful and powerful, but pretty juxtaposed to what I usually think of when I think of Ravel. And so Ravel was himself an interesting character. He was twice accepted and twice suspended or asked to leave from the conservatory, ended up studying with Faure, ended up being a lorry driver in World War I, and then directly after that came back and began this piece. And this piece was actually, there were many composers in France at that time who were invited to write a commemorative work for Debussy, who had recently passed away. And it was published in, it was called The Musical Review. It was prose, but also sometimes music. And this was a special edition of it. So he wrote this first movement and then later filled it out. It took 2 years to write the other three movements. Originally, he called it a duo, and he did know the Kodai. He was familiar with it. You may hear some parallels between the Kodai we just played and the Ravel we're about to play. He ultimately changed the name to Sonata. It's in four movements. Let's see. If you can just put yourself for a moment in France, after World War I, having seen everything that he saw on the front lines, and then coming home, on top of all the casualties of war, in France at that time they lost 450,000 people to the Spanish flu. So their economy was not doing well at all. They'd lost a lot of people. There were a lot of people without work. There were a lot of widows. There were a lot of orphans. And so I think you kind of can't play something like this or think about something like this, it had to have affected him in some way. So pouring whatever was inside of him out maybe a little bit into this. We really hope you enjoy. There are four movements and we'll play them without pause. Do you want to say anything else?
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Arts Council of Big Sky Virtual Classical Concert. I'm Angela Ahn, Artistic Director of Bravo Big Sky Festival, and I'm so thrilled that we have our very own Carrie Krause and Julia Slovarp with us this evening, along with amazing guest artists. I am so sad that we couldn't be together in person this summer for the entire full festival, but I know we'll be together next summer and we will have incredible music to share with you. Until then, I want to tell you how grateful I am for your continued support of our festival. And please stay healthy and be safe. And I look forward to seeing you next summer.
Our next set of performers are with us as part of Broke Music Montana. We are touring the state this week with a version of this program. And whereas I live in Bozeman, we oftentimes collaborate with musicians from out of state because we are playing on period instruments, either instruments from that era or replicas of, and it's a very specialized field. And so I feel very lucky to be able to bring some of my most cherished colleagues here because I love to learn from them and be inspired from them. And we're having a great week with this program that Nate designed for us. And Nate, maybe you might tell us a bit about the context of the program.
Yeah, thank you, Carrie. So it's a delight to be here with you guys this evening. It's a delight to be playing concerts these days. And the title of this program that we're touring is Più con meno, More with Less, which I think is a sentiment that we can all relate to during these times. There's a word that I've been hearing going around quite a lot recently, unprecedented. And I have to say that from an artistic perspective, that's a strange thing to say about these times. The time that we are dealing with here, the Baroque, was a time that far from being unprecedented, disease and war were ever present. The work that you just heard was by Dietrich Becker, who was a composer who was born in the middle of the 30 Years' War, which was a devastating war for what we now call Germany. Something like 20% of the population died. So far from being something that diminished their lives, these kinds of things inspired great art, and great art was made in spite of these challenges. Becker didn't write very much music, but I think what you just heard proves that it was of high quality and of great warmth and generosity. Now we're going to hear a little bit of a much more familiar composer, some work of J.S. Bach. I suspect you all know this one. I won't ask you to sing along. But then after that, maybe I'll talk a little bit more about the Baroque instruments that we're playing and the composers that you're going to hear. So please enjoy. Thank you.
The next piece on the program is by a composer, Heinrich Bieber, who lived in Salzburg and worked for the Catholic Church there as one of the best violinists of the time. And he wrote this amazing set of sonatas, which became known as the Rosary Sonatas. Each one is a meditation on an event in the life of Christ. And they're, what's particularly remarkable about them, besides the very beautiful manuscript that they were published in originally, which was obviously very expensive, these were special works from the get-go, is that they were, each sonata was written for a unique tuning system. So you're asked to literally mistune your strings. You know, you might tune your G string up to an A string, which gives each sonata a really distinct and expressive sound. And for one of them, you're even asked to cross your strings, and it forms a cross just below the bridge. That's for the Resurrection Sonata. This was a time in history for Catholicism, which featured very sentimental emotion, very overt emotionalism. You know, the art featured a lot of blood, and a very sort of personal, direct relationship with God. So that's what these pieces were used for. The one that I'll be playing, the Passacaglia, is the very last of the set of 15, and it's the only one that's written for the violin alone. And it starts out with four notes, which are repeated 64 times through the piece to form this Passacaglia. And the subject of it is the guardian angel.
So I think that Bieber is a spectacular demonstration of how one can do more with less, that one instrument can produce all of that variety, and that kaleidoscope of sounds and characters is really amazing. We have something very different for you now. The next piece on the program is by a composer that I would wager none of you have probably heard of, Michel Pignolet de Montéclair, who was a composer during the reign of Louis XIV, the Sun King. And the work, like many things under Louis XIV's reign, is a set of dances. Dance was well beloved by the French at this time, as it is now. And it's a work for two instruments that you do not see on stage. The astute among you will have noticed that neither of us is playing a flute. This is a duet for two flutes by Montéclair. Montéclair wrote very little music that we know of, but it's a very high quality, and he did it without the sort of lavish patronage that some of his colleagues in Paris enjoyed, composers like Couperin or Marais, who were working directly for the court. He was a bass player, so he was always doing more with less, and he was a music teacher, so much the same. The work you're going to hear is, we're going to do six movements from a much larger set of dance suites. It's in D minor, and though it's not for flutes, I find that this piece shows off the way that you can have two instruments of the same register do quite a variety of characters and have a great variety of sounds and techniques. So I've chosen these to show off the two bass instruments. And it's in a very different style from what you've just heard. The French characteristic style of the time, rather than being very extrovert and flashy, having lots of notes, lots of fast characters, sort of aural fireworks, the French were known for sort of elegance of line. They believed that rhetoric and architecture came first, and that all that extra glitz and glamour was somewhat extraneous. So what you're going to hear is quite a bit more subtle in some ways than what you've just heard, but no less exuberant, I think. These sets of dances, I hope you're able to hear, really have a kind of rhythmic drive to them and a simplicity that propels the dance. So I hope you enjoy.
Allemande. Thank you. Thank you.
So the last work on our program is a work by a very young Antonio Vivaldi. We think this may be the very first sonata that he wrote, actually. It's a very early work. It was only recently discovered in a collection in Italy, so it wasn't known for many hundreds of years. And Vivaldi, of course, was a master of doing more with less. He takes very simple ideas, very simple bass lines, and creates incredible fantasy out of them with millions of notes. We think it's a very fitting end to this program. I thought that this program, our lives these days are in some ways very diminished by the forces around us, and I thought that art and music was a great way to push back against that force in our lives. Artists have always found a way to make a great deal out of very little in hard times, and I think that's an inspiring message for right now. So we hope you enjoy this last work, Antonio Vivaldi's Sonata for Violin, Cello, and Continuo. It has three movements. Thank you.